Hey, welcome back. As we start our third segment on disability, language, media, and the arts, I'm going to talk a bit about the issue of accessibility. For many people, we don't give that much thought. Certainly, it wasn't something that I was particularly concerned with. And yet, if we think about the two groups that most often require some accessibility as related to accessing things online or videos, so forth. We think about people who are deaf or people who are blind. And so I want to talk a few minutes about both of those groups. If we think about people who are deaf, okay, and one of the ways in which they can certainly access the material being said is captions. As you'll note, we have within the MOOC, all of the lessons, everything we've got has captions available so that if you didn't hear what was said, you can at least read it and follow along. That's tremendously helpful. In a similar way, when we think about accessibility, it's been interesting from a captioning standpoint and captions on TV programs that required an act of Congress. That it used to be, if you were deaf and you wanted captions on TV, you had to buy a separate, it was almost kind of like a separate Blu-ray or DVD box, and it was fairly expensive. And that would then interpret the signal, and certainly there weren't that many programs that were captioned, but that was a required thing. To make the change, was a $5 computer chip. And deaf people lobbied the TV manufacturers, no one listened to them, so eventually it went through Congress. Act of Congress was passed that said in the 90s, every TV over 13 inches has to have this chip embedded in it so they can receive captioning. A $5 chip versus, say, a $300 device. And what we now know, too, is that captioning is used by far more people in restaurants, bars, and so forth than we think about it as used for people who are deaf. So although we've had a law that says everything needs to be captioned, in fact, all network programs need to be captioned now at this point, we still find in 2013 that there are many things that aren't yet captioned. Commercials on TV typically aren't captioned. Movie trailers typically are not captioned. And importantly, from a true accessibility standpoint, many, many videos and other materials that are available online are not captioned. But I would also ask you, and it's one of your activities for this week, I would ask you to go to YouTube and randomly pick a couple of videos, because you'll see a little thing on the YouTube video. It'll say CC, okay? And you click on that, and it'll give you a little menu, and it may say, English transcription, you're good to go. So somebody's already done it, or it may say automatic transcription. And when it does that, it uses a voice recognition software. So whatever is being said, this software listens, if you will, analyzes it, and then puts out what it considers to be the best, the best conversion. It's about probably 60% accurate, and so you can imagine some of the mistakes that happen. There's another activity that's associated with this lesson, and it might be beyond what many of you want to do, but we do have instructions available for how to add captions, so that if you wanted to post something on YouTube or any other media, that here are some instructions for how you might go about doing that. Because if you let the automatic transcriptioner do it, it's never going to be successful. It's never going to be high quality. However, if you put it in yourself, now you've got much more control. Another area where we think of accessibility has to do with sight. And this is a particular issue certainly for people who are blind. And how do they access the web? How do they access videos? Because lots of websites are designed in a way that don't consider accessibility right off the bat. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But also from the standpoint of, you have an image there. If you're blind, how do you know what the image is? And so there are things called described videos. The one thing I would mention as we begin to close this particular segment is the idea that from a website development standpoint, think about how important social media is and how important it is to have access to, whether it's shopping, whether it's social media, other types of networking, the design of those things to be made accessible for people who use screen reading software, where it's software that will tell you, read out loud what's on the screen. If that's been thought of ahead of time in the development process, usually it's not a huge deal to make it happen. Trying to make it happen after the fact is a real challenge. The other thing I would like to mention too on this, and this is also an activity within your list of things with this lesson, is it's called a Functional Accessibility Evaluator link. And it's a link that was created at the University of Illinois, and you can, for a single web page, you can put the URL, the web address, into this particular on this particular web page, the functional assessment evaluator, and it will tell you where there are any issues with accessibility on that particular page. You can sign up for a bit more involved version that can look at a whole, you know, series of web pages. But again, it's the thinking about it ahead of time that makes such a big difference as we look at this. I want to end with one of our students, guest speakers, who's going to talk a little bit about the importance for him of technology accessibility.
Assistive technology, it supplements the sense that has been damaged. So for a visually impaired or blind person, computers that will speak to you, and the majority of computers available now, there is a way to get a speech program on there that will read the entirety of the screen and allow the person to navigate using the keyboard without a mouse. And I know people who are totally blind who will navigate a computer faster using a screen reader than any sighted person I've ever seen. A friend of mine has actually made, call them headless laptops. It's just a laptop without the screen. And it's nice and easy to carry around, really small. It's like we had tablets before there were tablets, in essence.
So in summary, this particular segment was really focused on just kind of an awareness of accessibility issues, particularly as related to people who are deaf or hard of hearing, or people who are blind or have low vision. So for people who are of a hearing loss, the ability to see what's being said is huge. So captions are really, really valuable. They're also a value for many of us who are losing hearing as we get older from a baby boomer generation standpoint. So captions, something are, you know, should be routinely used and shared in classes and other public settings. And then for people who are blind, the ability to both navigate websites that have been designed for navigation with screen reading software, as well as within videos, the availability of descriptions so that when you're watching it and you're blind, you know what the images represent. And as we'll pick up in our final segment, we'll talk about some solutions, particularly the use of what's called person-first language.